Okay, we'll start the meeting. If you don't know, I'm Dan Brown, president of the Fair Board. I'd like to introduce the other Fair Board members. And we'll start with Peggy Lee, Jan Costa, Tom Miller, Missy Marino, Mickey Rucker, Marge Ehrlich, and Maren Kurtz. I think that's everyone. And at this time, if you wish, not necessary, but we're going to start with introductions. We'd like everyone to say who they are. And we'll start with Brian.
Okay, so I'm Brian May, working with the California Department of Food and Agriculture.
Jeff Seska with the Division of Marketing Services at the Department of Food and Agriculture.
Carol Seven. Fair member.
I'm Sue Moore, and I'm with the Small Livestock Association.
Elaine Eagle, I do clerking and work on the auction.
Brian Scheller, Sound Extreme Inspections.
Joe Werfer, I'm the chairman of the illustrious Gold Freebooters.
Scott Canning, resident.
Mike Baker, president.
Samantha, president.
Mark, one of the friends of the fair, Grounds.
Ricky Smith, member of the fair, Grounds.
Cody Nelson with Trader Corp.
Brian Farmer with Trader Corp.
Cindy Phillips with Trader Corp.
Jeff Gilmer with Trader Corp.
I'm Doug Kennedy, I'm one of the principals of Trader Corp. We're a Trader Corporation, for those who don't know, we're doing the beer garden and the bourbon barrel and the theater downtown on Steam Street.
Rachel Castania, Somerville Ag Teacher, and I work with Community Chair.
I'm Shirley Sarno, Sonora Chamber of Commerce, and also on the Friends of the Fair Board. Lisa Mayo, Quality County Visitors Bureau.
Dana Mayo, and I'm a resident.
George Segrini, Sonora City Council.
Connie Williams, Sonora City Council.
And Kathy Peacock, the Community Christmas Eve Dinner and Interfaith.
I'm a resident.
What's your name?
I'm Anthony Brown. I'm a former Fair Board here for 9 years.
Okay. Jim Garavano, Sonora City Council. And Table 8.
Good.
All right, well, it's great to see all of you here tonight. Appreciate you taking the time coming out. We'll try and get you out of here in the next 90 to 100 minutes. I know you're all here because you care about the fair and you want to see the fair continue to be successful as it has in the past. Our role is trying to shape, if you will, the roadmap for the fair as it moves forward into next year and years beyond. What are some of the key things that the fair needs to do? And when I say fair, I mean the fair and the fairgrounds. So I don't want to confuse the fair when I use that term as just being the three-day event. But it's really about how we shape the fair and the fairgrounds as we move into the future. As most of you know, the fair has lost or had its funding reduced from the state, as other fairs have in California. And this fair, along with other fairs in California, are trying to determine how they make up for that revenue loss. This fair, like other fairs, has a revenue problem, doesn't necessarily have an expenditure problem, because the fair has cut considerably over the last couple of years to try and make ends meet. So we're really focused in a large part on how we can be more efficient from an expenditure standpoint, but equally and more important, how we can generate new revenues. So the process that we're bringing to you tonight started back in 2013, when the board at that time undertook a strategic planning process. And they spent a couple meetings talking about what the goals of the organization should be, what its mission statement, which we've indicated down here in its vision. Those two aspects of the strategic planning process evolved out of meetings back in 2014. And then there was a series of 9 goals that the board at that time and the community that participated in the strategic planning process, there were 9 goals that were identified. That's kind of where the process ended. And so this is picking up where that process left off. And as you know, when you have goals need to have action plans. It's It's one thing you heard me say at the last meeting, Jeff has a goal to lose 30 pounds over the course of the next 3 months. What's he going to do in order to lose that 30 pounds? And so he needs an action plan or set of objectives, which might be, I'm going to work out every other day. I'm going to limit my calorie intake to, you know, 2,000 calories a day. In Jeff's case, he needs to cut back on drinking wine, so that might be part of his action plan. But what we need to do is develop an action plan for the goals that came out of that 2014 strategic planning process. Action plans are generally measurable. A goal is just kind of a broad concept, where an action plan or objective, just as I described in the example, is very measurable. We can go back and I can ask Jeff Friday or on Sunday, did he work out 3 times this week? And it's a yes or no answer, either met that objective or he didn't. So with your help, back on November 29th, we took the, actually 7 goals, we reduced the 9 to 7, and from the meeting on the 29th, we reduced the 7 to 5. So the 5 goals you see before you are indicated here on these big sheets of paper. And we reviewed the goals as we did the mission statement and the vision. And we wanted to verify with you, the board of directors, and you as the community, are these goals that were developed in 2014 still relevant? Are these the important goals that the fair needs to focus on over the course of the coming years? And with some minor tweaks, the consensus was, yes, these are the goals that we need to focus on. So with that being said, we need to develop an action plan for each of those goals. And we asked you as members of the community to assist us in developing those action plans. And what you see here is the work that was done by the community as small groups of people got together and developed an action plan for each of the goals. And so we're going to ask those committees and those committee chairs to present to you all tonight their action plans, their recommended action plans for the particular goal that they were assigned. Your job tonight is to give us feedback. We want to know, just as you might in my example, you know, that I just used in Jeff's desire to lose 30 pounds, and that's not his goal, but I'm using that as an example. In addition to some of the examples I gave you, working out every other day and limiting his, you know, calorie intake, you might want to add a couple things to that. You might say, I don't know, Jeff, what would be another objective if you wanted to lose 30 pounds?
Well, that might include, you know, a lot of people want to measure, you know, what their fat levels is, right, their fat percentage. So my fat percentage needs to go from 20% down to 18%. So, and I think what the reason is that, as Brian was mentioning, there's a lot of information that's up here, and the communities did a lot of work. There was a lot of time. But in order to sort of make sure that we have everybody's feedback, we want to make sure that we have your input to these action plans. And at one point, one of the agenda items also is, hopefully at one point, as you're going through this process with Brian presenting as well as the community, listen to the discussions, because at one point at the end, you can't accomplish everything. You know, we have a strong board, we're recruiting for a CEO, but over the next year, we can only accomplish so many things. So at one point we may ask the board, the community, what are the top one item or 2 items from each of the goals that we can focus in on over the next 6 months to a year. And then that recommendation will be taken back to the board on the 25th of this month for their consideration as well. So
as we invite the committee chairs up, again, we need your feedback. So there may be things that you think should be included as part of that action plan. We want to hear that feedback. If there are things in the action plan that you don't think are important or less important, then we want to hear that feedback. At the end of the night, we want to be able to have recommended action plans for the 5 goals that we'll present to the board of directors at their meeting on January 25th as recommendations. And then the board will then take some action as they move forward in determining, are these the action plans that they want to adopt? And they certainly have the, you know, same opportunity tonight to present information or you know, provide feedback as you do. But ultimately, either at the January 25th meeting or at the board meeting in February, we'll ask the board to adopt these as action plans, and that'll be our roadmap moving forward. So each month we'll ask the board, as part of its monthly board meeting, to review the action plans to see what kind of progress we're making as we move forward. So it's the roadmap that all of you believe and the board believes is going to be where we want to be, continue to be successful as a fair and as a fairgrounds, okay? So with that said, we're going to start with goal number five. And Rachel, you're going to come up and present goal number five. And if you would, introduce any members of your committee that are here, please. And so you'll find the same action plan that's up here. This is the action plan for goal number five. It's in your handout.
All right, well, if you're on my committee, if you can just raise your hand. I know I saw Ryan, Shirley, and Mary, three. I have one other that is coming. She's somewhere else. I'm not sure if this is on, but I don't think I'm with you. So our action plan, you can see it's the last one, and thank you for allowing me to go first. I need to get to another meeting. So unfortunately, I won't be able to be here to hear everybody else's ideas that came from them. Was to establish a comprehensive marketing, public relations, communications for the fairgrounds to increase attendance for the fair and also the grounds. And so we got together, and I think there was six of us that met, and I thought we were well represented. We had two large vendors that were there. So Ryan representing Sound Extreme and all the things that he does for events at the fairgrounds, as well as the Christmas fair was there. And so I felt like we had some good representations for people that know the marketing side of the fair. And we immediately decided to put it into two groups. So the action was to call the Mother Lode Fair. That would be the fairgrounds. So the Mother Lode fairgrounds, and then the Mother Lode Fair. And so we first talked about the fairgrounds. And what we said first, from a vendor point of view, and people that come into the fair, is we have some infrastructure problems. And so, he's not here tonight, but Craig Conklin, if you look down, we loved his lines, "We can't market lemons that don't taste good." And so we all got a chuckle out of that, but it was really true. It's really hard to bring in more vendors and say, "Hey, we have a great marketing plan, but we don't have the infrastructure." So some of the pinpoints were, we need to really look at how we can get grant money in, possibly through the state health and safety or other grants or local grants to help with our infrastructures. Some of the things were the bathroom issues, the AC heat issues, replacing the curtains, and leaky roofs. And again, it has to look good. We all know that it's easier to market something that looks good, is fresh, is clean. And so that was the biggest point to start off when we're looking at the fairgrounds. It's hard to put these in action steps. What we realized after kind of everything that we did, you know, it was hard at the bottom of each of our recommendations. We tried to put them in there. Most of these would be falling to whoever they hire to the new CEO. So as I'm talking, you know, most of these are going to go to that new CEO, unless the board comes up with other thoughts or ideas, or you guys here tonight want to jump in, that would be great. But really where we're at is this volunteer status. So with that, I'll kind of just briefly go through each one. You guys can all read it. They're there for you. If there's any clarification or questions, I'd be happy to entertain those. The first one is just that customer service approach. And so we felt like that was missing, and really running the fairgrounds as a business rather than this government entity, running it as a business and doing that customer service approach. And so when you're working with vendors, we felt like that was lacking, and both of our vendors had said years in the past, there was recommendations and thoughts that this year was a little better. However, that just that professional new approach with contracts, and there was certainly breach of contracts that came up, and we want to stay and clear away from those breach of contracts. So there was issues with the RV. So just, I know we have another RV group, that was another committee, but that needs to be a clear approach. What, where, when, what's happening with the RV group?
versus what's happening when we have a big, huge vendor event that has that RV space. So it's a lot of gray area, and we want to clean it up so that a vendor knows exactly what they're getting. It's written in their contract, and that is what they get, and there's no breach of contract. There's a lot that can be done for just that marketing aspect, and so we wrote some of those things down. We would like to have a CEO, so I don't know who's on that panel for the new CEO that has the marketing capability, that can do social media, that can get the word out there, that doesn't cost a lot of money, but knows how to utilize social media so that we can get those bookings and just have that website that looks great. We all know what that approach is, and the fair needs to take that on. The other thing is to having a clear-cut book. So if somebody calls in and says, you know, do you have this, we're thinking about doing this venue, that it's very clear-cut. We don't just give them a little brochure, that we have a whole book where they can see past events that we've had here. And Ryan has a ton of pictures where they have transformed a lot of our buildings into these wonderful events. He did say it took a lot of work to transform these buildings into wonderful events. However, he has those pictures. Why are we not putting those on a Facebook page or a book page where we can show potential vendors what they can do here at our fair, Fairgrounds? We definitely said that website needs to be updated. It's a critical marketing piece and everything that goes with that. Along with just keeping our vendors happy and making sure that we are working on that relationship and running it as a business, is making sure that we adhere to all the timelines, improving our communications before and after event, so we get feedback with our vendors, and if they're vendors that we know are here, that we can book that next contract right away, rather than there's lots of months of gaps, and we know that vendor's coming back, and we need to secure that contract in a timely and professional manner. We also wanted to entice new vendors with multi-year contracts, so what would be that added value, added benefit for them to sign a multi-year contract? And so the new CEO can come up with some of those value-added things to get a five-year contract or a three-year contract. We talked about the marquee and the signage, and there's lots of more things that we can do with that. Action step two was recruitment of new vendors. And so one of the ideas, and that's where maybe you guys have different ideas, how do we get new vendors in here, is one of our thoughts was to hold a vendor fair once we kind of have some infrastructure in place, once we have our book in place, once our website is up, and we can say, hey, we're ready to rock and roll with getting some new vendors in. So let's have a vendor fair. And you can see, you know, different people that we would invite. We could do some mock-ups, some setups, take some pictures, and kind of have a kickoff to potentially getting new vendors into our fairgrounds. Number three is just partnering with the local community. So that's a lot of you guys, and we looked at, there's a lot of people that may need rooms that are covered, and we're maybe not tapping in. We have events that are happening outside of our county, and we need to know why, and we need to maybe see how we can bring them into our county. We do hold the largest facility for tapping into those big events that need our facilities, and so we're just making sure that they're here, but that if anybody is wondering, we can bring in new people. So we looked at partnering, and that would be some cold calling from the new CEO. That would be, you know, setting up some of those situations and scenarios where you have everything in place, and now you're taking more of that business approach to foster those partnerships. We talked about signage, that the signage on the fairgrounds needs to be improved if we want to market it, and it needs to be well thought out. So maybe there's somebody in this audience that you've been a vendor, you've attended our fair, and you can maybe get a committee together to see what that signage needs to be. It needs to be well laid out. We also talked about our marquee where we can utilize and put for free, you know, it's just sitting there right now, that we could have people fill out a form and then it can say community things such as happy birthdays, anniversary, advertising for different events. And now we're getting money in from people using our signage out there. That was our committee report for the fairgrounds itself, for marketing of the fairgrounds. So now we're looking at the fair, Mother Lode Fair, which is in July. It's been shortened down to a two and a half day experience for the community and about a 5-6 day experience for the livestock portion of it. We talked about the fair experience, so it's in quotation marks, because what is that fair experience and what do we want to bring back? Some of you in the audience have been to the fair multiple years and have seen it change throughout the years, and so we all have a different thought process of what is that fair experience. And we all want attendance, we want it to be a money maker, but we want to step away from that fair saying, great, that was awesome, I can't wait to attend next year. So we have some marketing with the schools that we need to do. We need to bring that young generation in, so you can read down through that. Number two was just the layout and some of the infrastructure problems at the fair. So again, we're talking about signage. There's always the complaint, and as a livestock person, it is felt, you know, it's like two fairs, right? We have the carnival area and then we have the livestock area. So how do we brainstorm to get it to feel like it's a whole fair and not so separate? A lot of that has to do with signage. The recommendations just for the fair experience, and this wasn't action items, this was just more thoughts to come in. You can read down through that, but a big part of it is the program of the fair. Nobody knows what's going on when, and we would like to have more local vendors. We're a small hometown fair and most of our vendors are out of town, and so it'd be nice to bring that small town back in. And I know that the fair board are working on that, and that's part of their theme this year is Meet Me at the Fair, which is more hometown. And it's hot during the fair, and so if we can somehow think of a water feature, there's a lot of kids there, and so some, I remember 2 years ago, I mean, there was just a little fishing pond, but that was like a big deal for my kids, right? It was like water. And so if there's some sort of water feature that we can do, or misters or something, just to bring, you know, bring the temperatures down, that would be great. The last thing that the committee wanted me to emphasize was that we really need to put things in categories, and so that may be something that the fair board can do that can be done for cost. We're gonna have to put a dollar amount behind it, no cost. Does it need to be staffed or not staffed? So really to take this all and to prioritize it. Sorry, that's the end of my report.
Good stuff. Excellent. And a lot of stuff that's probably very doable. Mickey?
I didn't want to interrupt that, but Rachel, I think this would be a perfect opportunity to maybe have Doug Kennedy give an idea of some of the things that he has, being that he's talking about bringing some new events to the fairgrounds. So if
sure.
You could speak for a few minutes for sure. That and thank him for the Trade Corporation.
Before Doug speaks, can we get some feedback on any comments or questions on anything that's raised?
Actually, I have some feedback on the website idea, and I think you guys are on the right track. I will say from our vantage point, even at Trado and up at Reverb where I was working on the video game stuff, we've moved completely against websites. And we've done it in a manner because A, it's really expensive to maintain them, but what you do is you get the URL and redirect it to a Facebook page, and pretty much everybody's on Facebook, and you can update Facebook minute by minute. And it really has a bigger impact in terms of everybody being on Facebook, seeing what's going on, pictures being posted. So if you type in the URL, say it's Mother Lode Fairgrounds, if you type in the URL, it just redirects you to the Facebook page. And then you can have multiple administrators, rather than having to have someone that really knows about HTML doing massive website updates, which cost a lot of money and they take a lot of time to do. Just how we're approaching it from our side.
Thank you.
On that note, does anyone know who has the current admin rights to the Facebook page?
We're working on that.
Okay. I know, I was looking at it and
there's like three.
Okay. There hasn't been anything published since 2013.
During the fair last year, the Facebook page said the fair was closed.
Right.
There's a Friends of the Fair page which myself and someone else have admin rights. And I was just looking into the other one. And if I can think that, I think. Or even Stacy, who created it?
No, it was done during when Don was here.
Yes, exactly. Thank you for that expression.
Thanks for calling us.
No.
Any other comments?
It's interesting as we go through this presentation here, how much the groups are going to dovetail with ideas. Because things that you reported your group discussed, I know the group I was in discussed some of the same things. So it's going to be interesting to see how they all fit.
I'm impressed. I mean, this is like based on our group over in the fair industry. I mean, they're bringing forward stuff that, you know, a lot of the bigger fairs do. A lot of the smaller fairs don't have the resources, but this is really good stuff. This is spot on. Okay, any other thoughts? We'll come back to this because when we get to the end, we're going to try and prioritize a couple of things that we think we can act on quickly. So if there aren't any more comments, Doug?
Yeah, I didn't really prepare anything, but I can talk a little bit about what we're doing and give you guys some perspective on how we're approaching events and community and such. So a little background about myself. I've been in the Mother Lode for about 20 years now. I was one of the key members that helped bring the Ironstone concert series in the Murphys. I've worked at Reverb Communications, which is a video game marketing public relations firm up in Twain Heart, where I was the CEO and one of the founders. And in the last couple of years, I left to start the Trado Corporation with a couple of partners, and that brought the Bourbon Barrel in downtown, and subsequently we bought the building, and we're doing the Beer Garden, we're redoing Stage 3, and we're trying to create a downtown entertainment center. With that, you met some of the group here from Trado. We've developed and created a team that's going to work downtown. We bought the Cowden Building, and we're all housed in the Cowden Building. Marketing, social media, public relations, and events. And so I've been having conversations with Mickey over the last few months about how do we get more involved in the fair facility to bring more events downtown and to bring more events in. I mean, obviously you guys have the Celtic Fair and you've got the Roundup and you've got the fair, but how do we stretch out some additional events throughout the year that might attract a different audience? And that's kind of what you guys are talking about on the PR front. And we have a laundry list of things that we want to approach the board about in terms of not looking for money and not requesting anything other than let us rent the facility and start bringing in more things that are going to bring people into the community, hopefully show up at the Bourbon Barrel and a few other places and some of the other downtown businesses. So we've been looking at the schedule of events that you guys have, the calendars, and then looking at the demographics of the community in terms of how do we attract more 12 and 13 and 15 year old kids that want to spend a weekend down at the fairgrounds, either at a video game expo, a pinball expo, or things like that, but also merge some of the things we're doing with microbrews, barbecue festivals, and things like that. So we are going to be approaching you guys within the next 2 to 3 weeks to talk about the calendar events that we want to present to see if there are open dates that we can rent from the fairgrounds and the facility, and then figure out ways, how do we work together with you guys that as we bring revenue in, what are some of the infrastructure things that we can do to help improve the infrastructure here that starts attracting more and more events over the next couple of years? So, any questions? So we're gonna be, hopefully not too aggressive, we're gonna be very aggressive over the next probably month in trying to call meetings, sit down with you guys, present what our events look like and make sure they mesh with what you guys are looking for here at the facility, and then try to get into a contract and look to start, probably we'd look at our first event being in October and then look at every 3 or 4 months after that with 4 events taking place in any calendar year.
So Doug, you don't think the current infrastructure of the fairgrounds is gonna hinder your ability to put on these kinds of events?
I think it will, but I think the infrastructure is what we have, and unless somebody wants to make a huge grant payment, I think we're stuck with what we have. Now, can we work around that? Absolutely. We'll work around it, but you know, as we start bringing in more events and doing more things down here, what we'll look for you guys to do is have a sit down with us and a commitment that there is going to be some reinvestment into the fairgrounds that can help support either the size of the events as we grow them or the type of events that we're going to bring in. So.
Well, and I think too, I mean, I have GoTuolumne and some of the other visitor-related organizations probably right. should be at the table too, because it sounds like what you're proposing is going to have a regional outreach maybe.
That's the hope and the plan. I mean, we've got the team here who's been sitting down looking at, you know, housing facilities, how do we have, what hotels are in the area, how much can we accommodate in terms of the type and level of events that we're looking to bring in. And look at that. I don't want anybody to get the misunderstanding that the first event we're going to do is have hundreds of thousands of people rolling into Tuolumne County. But if we grow the events in the right manner, over the course of, you know, 1, 3, 5 years, we should see a sustainable growth that brings in both barbecue enthusiasts, brings in video game enthusiasts, and depending on the type of events that we're bringing, starts to create a mecca for those style and types of events that people plan their years around, where they go, hey, every year in August we go to this, or every October we show up at that. And so it just becomes an annual event. You're going to get different groups and different types of people coming in, which will fill hotels, fill restaurants, and have them starting to come to Sonora once again.
Okay, great.
So that's kind of what we're doing. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Let me step up now and follow up with what he just said. I wrote a note to myself. To succeed, the fairground needs thousands of people every week. A dynamic venue will be our guarantee of success. Here is such a venue. And here's a colorful little quick sketch of a few ideas. You can share them or shoot it down. The main thing is that a racetrack on the fairgrounds. High speed racing, modifies, that sort of thing. That's about eight months out of the year. Every weekend, people really get into it. I don't know how many of you like racing here, but it grows on you. You go a few times and it's just a fun thing. A few beers, hot dogs, good food, place for the kids, whole family. This is a kind of little map, you know, here's the track to the back, the street out here. Miniature golf course. The whole family usually together, they like to get out and play a little golf, bring the kids. And this will go along with this water feature, the lady mentioned. That could be included on the outskirts of this. They have a couple of bocce courts. It's an old Italian game, you familiar with it?
Yeah.
Like bowling with wooden balls, one game. You rent these things, you know, you rent the space, and same thing you pay to play the golf. Money coming in. Go to the races, buy food, money coming in. I have here a dance. Dance, gym, and for kids. So the ladies can come, or the whole family. Exercise, you pay a little bit. The kids got a place to entertain them. Like Burger King on the outskirts of town. They have an indoor playground for the kids. You have the same thing. Bring the people out, something to do. This and some other things. They have a kitchen over here by this racetrack in the back that would serve all kinds of food. I'm thinking of steak sandwiches. Country steak sandwiches. Done well, they're great. You got beer, hot dogs, French fries, colas, the works that you normally would have. And I have a tent I'm showing. This is just rough and dirty. We have buildings all over the place, and I put a little pink in there to kind of pop them out a little bit. Next to that, I got gaming. That's going to scare you a little bit, but people like to game. They go to the Zinni casinos and spend all kinds of money. Something to do with their time. They enjoy it. We should have it. Besides bingo, this morning, we could have cards like a little card. And maybe slot machines. Why not?
All right. And your name, I'm sorry? Your name was?
Doug.
Doug.
I'm an architect and general building contractor.
All right. Thank you, Doug.
Congratulations.
Appreciate it. Okay, let's go to goal number four. Lisa, are you going to present? Would you introduce your group, please?
Hi, group here. And I don't think Chris is here. Mickey? Okay. And Melinda wasn't able to make it. But pretty much everything that we had has already been said tonight. The big thing that this is my first time really being involved with anything with the fair, so I think it's kind of a good thing because I kind of had a blank slate to start with. But the big thing is that we felt like we can't really expect to get sponsors and new sponsors with the way things are, the state of maintenance or lack thereof. So we felt that we needed to have a history of how this, you know, how sponsorships have worked. And we didn't really have that. Mickey was able to give us some insight, but we didn't really have that to go off of when we looked at this. But really the main thing was the repairs and upgrades have to be done before the fairgrounds can expect to have continued sponsor support. So one of the ways of doing this, we thought, was to get a working list of here's what needs to be done. Here's how much it's going to cost and what's the priority. And that was really important because we felt if people are just giving money and it's like, okay, well, there's still that roof that's leaking or there's still this problem over here, and they're not really seeing the things that might be important to them. By having a list, sponsors might be able to say, okay, that's $3,200. I can take care of that. And it's something maybe they might want to do in kind, or maybe that's part of their sponsorship for some event at the fair. We also talked about ongoing sponsorships. So where you're not just sponsoring the fair, but you're sponsoring, maybe your name's on a sign when you come in, you know, your company name, that type of thing. We wanted to get to a point where we could have a luncheon for sponsors, for past sponsors, for current sponsors, and for future sponsors, where everything would just be laid out and transparent on this is the state of the fair, so to speak. It would be interactive. We would want to know what kind of things they look at when they're deciding to sponsor, what helps them make decision, and if they're not wanting to sponsor, what is it that's keeping them from not wanting to sponsor? So we thought it'd be great if this luncheon was put on with the help of 4-H and FFA, maybe the culinary class at the high school, and really get the youth out so that people could remember that this is a lot of this is about the kids. And so we thought that was a good thing. Creating a capital fund that would be specifically for the different repairs and improvements, again, a prioritized list of those improvements that need to be made. We also talked about sponsorship packages. So if you sponsor an event and it's at the arena, maybe you have to shoot sponsors, and I think that was something that maybe was done in the past. Looking at some of the things that were done before and actually worked. We also talked about revisiting out of area companies that might want to be sponsors, and also revisiting places that haven't been sponsors in a while. So, and maybe businesses that have been overlooked in the past too. So really a lot of things that kind of tie in, but really it's about setting those priorities of repairs and needs and getting those taken care of to grow into bigger and better things. That's all I have.
Thank you. Have you guys considered having sponsors for each individual building? Because I think what Lisa touched on is there is a pride thing that if I have an organization or a business and there's a dilapidated facility, I'm not going to want to put my name on it. Just like if I have sponsored the facility, I'm going to want to make sure it's fixed up and kept up. It's kind of like putting your name on the side of the highway. You don't want to drive by and see my name on the highway and there's trash everywhere. You're going to get everybody together and go out and clean up because it's embarrassing. I think if the buildings had, you know, the JS West building, or, and I don't mean to throw a business under the bus here, but if it had a specific company that was responsible for that building, whether they wrote a check or brought their team members down or did whatever to clean up around the building, paint the building, if it's a roofing company, they can fix the roofs on the building, but just kind of go in that direction.
I'm the only trade-off.
I get it lined up and we'll look at sponsoring.
Barrett, can you answer that question? Next question.
I think we would be, I mean, I don't think it's been explored, but I think we'd be happy to put a name on a building if somebody gives us.
The John Muir is going to now be Trado Corp.
It's been discussed in livestock for potentially having sponsors of different barns.
For the barn.
So, yeah, we have.
Like sponsor a building.
Right.
Where they may say, all right, we'll be, you know, we will maintain the building as far as the outside facade. So we'll do the painting and any wood repair. And then maybe another would do roofing and maybe an HVAC would take care of the HVAC. So you have three plaques that this building is supported and maintained by our local partners, including, you know. And so some fairs have done that.
Sure.
And so that's something that can be developed. There are forms that, you know, other forms that other fairs have created. And if that is an idea, we can certainly share that.
Has it been successful with other fair facilities?
It depends. It really goes back to, like, it was presented, having a good idea of what is needed for that particular building and costs to improve the building, the outside, the inside, whatever is going to be supported, and making sure you just sort of get out there and try to drum up that level of sponsorship. Is you just don't put a sign and say, looking for sponsorships. You need somebody very active, and usually that goes back to the CEO and or the board member or members to actively pursue those building sponsorships.
Yeah, I mean, this area doesn't have a shortage of contractors.
Yeah.
That would love to get their name on things down here, and they sure have the means and the wherewithal to come in and actually start fixing it.
Yeah, so there's some, like San Joaquin County, they've stopped it as a sponsor on one of their buildings. Now, they attract about 1 million people a year to their venue, and so everybody's walking down the main street of the fairgrounds, and they see the Big Bang has stopped it on the building wall. So it does, as Jeff said, it kind of varies by community and by area. So, any other comments or thoughts? I mean, I love the sponsor luncheon idea, particularly.
I just want to mention that the Calaveras Fair, they had quite a deal on their website about, they call it partnership, sponsorship, and they list in detail what the $10,000 sponsor right. gets, the $5,000, and the $1,000, and it's well worth looking at, give you an idea of what you can present to the sponsor to encourage their money.
We're going to invite the CEO of the Calaveras Fair has agreed to come to the February board meeting to kind of share their experiences. They were kind of in a position that we're in today, 3-4 years ago, and what they've done. So, you know, we've cautioned people, what works in one community doesn't work in another.
Sure.
But just to kind of hear what a fair just right down the road, and most of you probably know that they had some major infrastructure issues that ate up most of their income, but they've rallied. Pretty good footing. So any other comments? Lisa, her group, Vicki, Sue, thank you very much. Lisa, thank you. Okay, so goal number three.
That would be us. And I realized as I walked in the door that I had my most official headgear on. But our choice is to take it off and have a hat here. So I'm sorry, folks, you're going to have to go with the gears. Our goal was to enhance and grow the volunteer program and increase the membership of Friends of the Fairgrounds to provide for a pool of volunteer resources to support the operations of the fairgrounds on an ongoing basis. I was there. Our board liaisons were Jan Cost and Tom Miller. They were there. We had three community members show up, all of which were already on the Friends of the Fairgrounds. So we were able to be pretty efficient because they have been dealing with this for, I don't know, ever, to increase their membership. We all agreed that this would have to have, whatever we're going to do is going to have a fair amount of structure, or it's going to be like herding cats. Just having a bunch of volunteers, you know, running amok is not really very productive. So, number one would be to determine how many volunteers we need and for what, and this will help to steer what kind of people would be the best candidates. Do we need people who are crack spreadsheet creators? Do we need nail pounders? I mean, what do we need? So we're going to have to identify what we need, and then we can go about trying to find those people, which is the second one, identify projects and uncapped groups who might be useful for those specific projects. And there could be the general volunteers that we need to keep the fairgrounds functional and to help man the fair, as well as certain other projects which might come along. Number three is really important to identify a volunteer coordinator. I don't mean a coordinator who's a volunteer, I mean somebody who coordinates the volunteers, who does herd up the cats. So the board will have to identify somebody who will do that. That's going to be a big job. You're going to have find somebody that is really, 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 really committed and loyal to do this for no money. That's going to be a big job. Number four would be to establish and clarify who is responsible for training and supervising these volunteers. Is that the fair board? Is that the Friends of the Mother Lode Fairgrounds? I mean, who's going to train up the cats? And to reinvent the Friends of the Fairgrounds, which, as I said, they've been beating this up for quite some time. One of the things that came up with, and it came up in one of these meetings also, would be to be more responsive, to people who apply, for example, contact them and make them feel welcome to the group. Make it more attractive for potential members. What does a person get if they become a member of the Mother Lode Fairgrounds, other than the ability to come to some meetings and work really hard sometimes in the year? What might be a little bit more attractive? Learn social media. I mean, that came up in Rachel's group. Really? Seriously? Our website has, the Facebook page hasn't been updated since 2013. Come on, even I can do that, and I'm really old. So we for sure have to do that, I think. Promote events that people want to participate in. We have a lot of people here who are looking for something to do. Why don't we figure out what they might want to do and have it here? Thank you, Doug. Stuff like that. I mean, we hear all the time that, especially the young folks, there's nothing to do in this town. So why don't we find out some ideas that might get down here? And give members something for their money. We already talked about that. And they even suggested look at changing the meeting times. Now, I don't know if Friends of the Mother Lode Fairgrounds has had any further meetings about this, or is there anything you guys want to share? We happen to have the president here.
We haven't had a meeting since.
Okay.
We have a meeting tomorrow night.
Okay.
Changing the meeting time is on the agenda.
Okay.
As well as creating a bigger email list.
Okay. And like all the other groups, or most of the other groups, I'm sure, are going to, we can come up with all kinds of good ideas, but we're going to get a new CEO, potentially, we hope, anyway, and really these are board responsibilities, you know, as evidenced by the fact that this was the strategic plan that they came up with several years ago. So I hope you guys do something with all these good ideas. Any questions, comments, want to wear my hat?
I would like to add one other step to the action plan, and that would be to reach out to other fairs who have successful Friends of the Fairgrounds or Friends of the Fair program, and learn from them in terms of how they grew their membership and what their role is and how they've become a big part of the operation.
My understanding, and I could be wrong, but I've had several people tell me that Calaveras has an army of volunteers. So I'm really hoping that lady can share some ideas. How is it that they have an army? How do they herd up all those cats, right? Love all those people? So I'm glad they're coming.
And one thing that the volunteer program is going to be especially critical this year, in January, there, in December, at the very end of the year, the fair board passed a balanced budget, and a lot of work, blood, sweat, and tears went into that budget by many members of the committee providing information and about what we can do. And well, in order to balance that budget, paid volunteers, but individuals who were historically paid while working at the fair have been replaced with volunteers. So in order to decrease the cost to balance the budget, we had to remove paid individuals and replace them with volunteers. So the need for volunteers as we approach the 2017 fair is going to increase. So when I was looking through a lot of this one sort of jumped out at me that I had seen this, you know, budget presentations being made in their life. This one is going to be extremely critical, especially as we approach fair.
Yeah, and I think for sure that the number one thing on this particular effort is to figure out how many people do we really need. What do we need to do? And then just go from there.
That's great.
So comments, questions, additions? Another good report, thank you. So you get a sense of where we're going now. So again, we're trying to create this roadmap. We're not going to accomplish everything in the next month or next 6 months, but it gives us a plan in which we can move forward and begin accomplishing some of these. I'm not hearing any objections to any of the presentations.
No objection, but to go along with what the Friends of the Fair do, I mean, that's our only way of bringing in the money, you know. So it's very important that I think we reach out to the community and have more people come friends. Not expensive to do so, and there are 501(c). So I think that we need to really promote that in the community and make sure people understand that that's how we're going to be able to get a portion of our revenue.
The tag on the mission, like you said, so a big part of the theme that's come out of every presentation is the infrastructure. How are we going to come up with money to improve the facilities and grow the business? The Friends are critical in a capital campaign. We're going to talk about a capital campaign next, because we need the nonprofit in order for private sector to want to be able to contribute money. The fair is not a nonprofit. So if Tradeco writes us a check for $10,000, your accountant's probably going to tell you that you're not going to be able to write that off as a charitable donation. But because the Friends of the Fair are 501(c)(3) or something along that line, then we'll have that vehicle in which to exercise the opportunity for the partner. Okay? All right, so goal number two, Jim?
Yes.
And by the way, thanks for all the city council people who are here tonight. That's awesome, you guys are here.
So our goal was to create a capital campaign with the assistance of Friends of the Fairgrounds to raise funds to support the Mother Lode Fairgrounds five-year capital improvement program that results in increased use of the fairgrounds and provides an appealing, beautiful presence in the community. And we met here at the fairgrounds. The board liaisons were Dan Brown and Peggy Lee, and the other two members that came were from Friends of the Fair, Bart Bloom and Joanne McDonald. We had a discussion, and we kind of came down to what I collated into about 8 different points. First one is to recruit a chief fundraiser, a project manager from the community. We felt that a point person was essential to keep the projects moving forward. The second item was to mix the projects together to achieve success, match unappealing projects with appealing ones, because if you're try to build a mini amphitheater, everyone might want to think that's a great idea. If you want to raise funds to lay sewer pipe, that's probably not the best, most appealing fundraising thing. So if you kind of mash them together, it's more likely that you can get the fundraising for both. Three is identify all the philanthropic organizations in the communities, like the foundation. You know, first thing that everyone thinks of when it comes to mind is the Sonora Area Foundation, but there are other organizations out there that, you know, can be tapped, and we should make sure that we're trying to tap all of them. Four, identify supporters for certain projects, and the example that came up was if you're going to build a gazebo, that's a structure for a wedding, maybe you talk to the bridal shops in the area, see if they want to be partnering with fundraising for that item. So matching the vendor or business with the project. Five, identify useful mailing databases, both snail mail and email, of course, to reach out, do a better job of reaching out. Six, make sure the Friends of the Fairgrounds has buy-in and allow them to choose only projects that they're capable of succeeding. You know, they're kind of a small organization, and you know, they might not be able to bite off every single project, even a huge project. And we want to make sure that they're, you know, you know, don't give them a project that, that the group may not be able to handle. Seven, make sure that capital projects have wide scope. Make sure that the fundraising is for the entirety of the fairgrounds and not just the fair itself. But a lot of people get that misnomer that, you know, what's the fair? Is the fair the 3 days? Or is the fair the entire year round? Well, to be successful, we have to make sure that the fairgrounds are successful all year round. So, you know, make sure that those projects fit that. And eight is new capital projects should begin with a well-publicized kickoff event to maximize fundraising efforts. You know, it's definitely the marketing aspect of that, so. And Peggy, Dan, Bart, you want to have any thing that you want to add, or? Put you on the spot, Bart. Put you on the spot, Bart. No, if you don't, that's fine.
Well, part of, well, you know, one thing is the gazebo thing for weddings has been around for a long time. Part of what we need to do at that time is clean up the grass area if it's going to be down by the livestock area. You know, it's kind of a barbecue grass area. That's all we talked about. You need to do more than just a gazebo. You need to dress the rest of it up too. And,
so kind of match, not just the project, but match what's surrounding the project.
Plus, you know, you've got this huge covered area down there. So if you have a wedding in April and it decides to rain,
you got a place to go, right, exactly.
We also have a wedding event coming up here.
That's my affair.
A wedding affair.
So, you know, that's something where, you know, we've got a lot of people in that.
All about 400 people and about 125 registered brides that have come to the fairgrounds. And the fair has never participated in a booth there.
Thank you for bringing that up. That's important. I mean, we have a captured audience here. We have to be participating and selling and marketing the fairgrounds as a potential thing. Thank you.
Need to have something to market.
No, granted. I hear you.
That's what you need.
I hear
first.
You.
And then go to the event and set up a
booth. So, any comments? Great report, Jim and Peggy, Dan, and Mark. Thank you for your help with that. Any comments? Okay, so all good stuff. Let's go to our last priority goal. Angela Brown's going to give the report for Jim Costello. Jim had something come up today and had to leave for the Bay Area, so Angela's going to pitch in for him. And Peggy, I think you were part of that. You were present for that as well, so. Angela, would you like to sit down?
No, if I have to, I will.
Okay.
We'll try this.
And
we met at
just
McDonald's.
Found out
we met at McDonald's and it was raining as much there as it is here. So I feel like we're all wet. We took a different approach. Many of the things that you talked about in your other groups have somehow filled in on some of the things we did. What we were looking at was, if you have an event here at the fairgrounds and you're using your maintenance people, you're using your office people, is your rate that you're giving for that event being able to pay for the maintenance hours? If you have an 8-hour maintenance man, if you have an 8-hour maintenance man, or if you have where the office staff had to go and do 8 hours of work, is that event paying for what services they want? And that really seemed to be one that they felt they needed to do an evaluation on those costs, so that then, as you go down here, you'll see one of the things they also looked at was the rates that we were charging people. Were we overcharging, undercharging? Were we pretty much standard? Another one to go into that would be that what they wanted to do was go to the different events around here and see what they're charging. So to see if we're comparable, to see if we're too high, too low, to see how it works. One of the big things that, I'm not going by numbers, is that going to mess you up?
No.
Okay. One of the other things that we felt was that people that come and use the fairgrounds, renters, renting the buildings, that we heard that day there were a lot of people who were not coming back because they were not happy with the services that they got here. And one of the things that we felt that if we had had a sheet where they could critique the event or critique what the fairgrounds, what was it that they were unhappy about, or what was it that they were unhappy and happy about, and for them to want to come back and use the fairgrounds again. Another one was creating a system with the computers so that you would have a list of all the different people that are renting your buildings. The name of whether it's an organization, who the contact person is, who if so-and-so just wanted it for a wedding, and see if they would like to come back and redo. Now there's a lot of events that, and you mentioned it over here, that you don't know because they're not signing up for their event for the next year right then and there. They wait 6 months, or they wait so many months, maybe because they think it's, we're not going to rent it. But anyway, what happens is they want to be able to get those people to come back in and get them, you know, sign up for it, rent them immediately. Taking that information, putting it on whether the web or Facebook or whatever it is, we were looking at a web, and putting up a calendar of events so that I come in and I want to pull up an event, and I can go on the Mother Lode Fairgrounds and I can pull up their calendar and I can see if that date is being used. So that you're giving this information to the people. That was really important. They feel like there's not enough. You have the world of computers here and you're not using them. And that you need to use these computers, this information, to be able to get out and touch other people, to be able to bring clients back in, to find out if they're happy with the events, what things would they like to see happening at the fairgrounds. Really important stuff, just good stuff. Rail rates was a real big one because they don't know, you know, I was a fair board director, and those buildings down there look the same as they did when I was a fair board director. So it's not like there's been any big heavy change. There might be updates on the kitchen and things like that, but the buildings are concrete. This one is probably one of the nicest ones. And I think what they were trying to look at, and I don't want to screw this up, see, I get it, is the rates and what you can do. You know how you talked about a bridal fair? Yes. And you want to do a bridal fair. We have had these buildings used. One was for, especially if someone has a large business known in Tuolumne County, where they've had memorials here. And they brought in thousands of people, you know, or hundreds, many people. And maybe bring different people down here and schedule a day where you would bring in, oh, this sounds really funny, but funeral directors, people who plan weddings, service clubs, I think they were talking about different things with the rodeos, different things, and show off what it is we have here at the fairgrounds so we can sell it. And we were really hoping that would happen. Friends of the fair, we love you, we want you, whatever you can do to help us, we'd be there to help you too. They're really concerned about CAL FIRE and United States Forest Service. I didn't think that was a problem, but it seems like having them come here and using the fairgrounds as a staging event. And they felt that we needed to reevaluate with CAL FIRE and, you know, with and the USF. The other one was the RV groups. I can tell you from the past, we didn't use the RV groups programs like you do today. And there's a lot of money out there. Whether or not you want to be able to pull more RV groups in is something you need to decide. But there is money to be made, and there are groups that would like to stay here, rent a building, and, have their little parties and things that they have. So we're encouraging the RV. And to get into publications, a lot of you don't get into publications, and I know they're expensive. It would be like going into Sunset Magazine and having somebody, having a Sunset Magazine has where to go and what to do, having the Mother Lode Fairgrounds. Other ones would be RV publications, but getting the name out and using it. Last is the same thing, it's just looking at your business plan and looking at your revenue, making sure that your costs are well done. I think cost is a big, have you ever hear this? Okay, most of you know who I am. I had a catering and business for 28 years, and it really got me when I went to rent a building and they nickeled and dimed me. You know what nickel and dime means? Well, I'll tell you. You don't want to go back there too many times because you know it's going to cost you 10 times more than what you want. And one thing that I think that if you want to get people to want to come back here is you want to give them a price. They know what the price is when they walk in the door so that when they plan their event, they're going to plan it. So that's when, not come back a week or two later and say, oh, we're going to up it here and up it there. It doesn't work. So that was one. The people on the committee were Jim Costello, which he's no longer on it, myself, Delaine, Hagel, Missy, Marge, Jim, and Peyton. We need a new chairman. And it was fun coming back and looking at the fairgrounds in a different way than it was 40 years ago.
Angela?
Okay, thank you, Angela.
To what Angela had talked about as far as the online calendar, and a good one to go look at is Columbia County. You can look at any of their facilities, see what's open, what dates. You can submit your online application, and until you send the funds in, they don't reserve it. Given our limited staffing hours here at the fair, let's have a computer system work for us. And I don't care if the person puts the application in at 11 o'clock at night. It's going to be there when someone comes in. So we have the option to try and do business in hours that we don't actually have to have staff and pay a body to be in the office.
Yeah, thank you.
So there is some incredible resources out there to look at making things work for us.
The sad thing about it today is if you don't use the computer, you're not going to get a lot of stuff done.
We still have a person here that answers the phone some of the days.
Yeah.
But a lot of your people, you can...
And a pamphlet. I don't remember anybody saying anything about a pamphlet. What do you call the, isn't that a pamphlet?
Brochure.
That's one thing you need too. And I think that would, for the people who are not online but have a hard copy of a pamphlet, I think that would be really good. And that's where you would bring in Ryan, where you would do some pictures of different things that have been, and you would use those on whether it be a wedding or whether it be, different things like that. But those were really big I don't know why it wasn't on there, but the pamphlet was
really we've had two weddings that I've attended alone that have been held in the barns down there. They were beautiful, and they're both totally different.
And what a great selling point.
Facilities that we aren't even featuring to the public.
Yeah.
But that's, any view of what's out there, and people can't always imagine it.
That pamphlet was a real big one, because we felt that people, they have something in their hand, and they, when they go, I asked for a calendar. I haven't gotten it yet, but I would love to know, and I think you would too, is how many people rent the Mother Lode Fairgrounds that don't live in Fallon County. You might be real surprised that there's a lot more people out there who would rent it because they can drive from the city and come up here and get everything they want to do. Hey, you got $1 million thing.
Kathy, you have a question?
I do. Angela?
Oh, I'm sorry.
In another life I had, I used to work at a place as a volunteer, and you were the fairgrounds event host. And that was for each event that came along, a host was appointed to touch bases with the incoming group what they need, how are they doing, if there's anything they have questions about, how do they do the contact information, emergency disaster plan stuff, you know, stuff like that. And maybe touch bases during the event and then afterwards, like you were talking about a critique, or someone was, of how did it go, what could we do better, is there anything else you'd like to add or say or add on to that? And it was all volunteer. There was nobody who was paid, and there was probably 50 events that we had volunteers assigned to an event. And it worked out beautifully, because then the vendors felt like people were mattering. I do the Christmas dinner down here, and for the last 3 years, we haven't seen staff people to know what, how do I deal with a disaster? We've had disasters each year. Fortunately, Peggy Lee was here this year and guided us through this one. So it's, I think that just, I'm kind of in the trenches person. I'm not, I don't get all this high stuff and when it's the fair and when it's the fairgrounds and when it's the friends and when it's the board. I get down there, I hear and listen to what people say out in the community about stuff. And the bottom line is, well, there's no other place big enough, so I guess we have to go to the fairgrounds. Well, that's a crappy kind of a reason to use the fairgrounds, in my mind. They should say, oh, guys, that fairgrounds is a perfect place. You know, that kind of a thing. And so the host's jobs were to promote that and make sure they came back the next year, like you were saying. You know, make sure that they are welcome to or would like to, kind of thing.
Do I know my answer to you?
What?
Pat, I'm nobody.
Oh.
I mean, I'm just a person here. I'm not anything on the fairgrounds, fair board. I think that if you, with the idea that you just came up with, is to look at one of the goals and put your body on one of those committees so that you can get that, because I think that is really important. I don't know how successful it would be or how it would work out, but I think for you and knowing who you are, that you need to get yourself up here and put yourself on one of these committees. Yes, oh God. Yes.
Thank you, Angela.
No, you're welcome.
I'll get you
I
later.
I love you too. Yes.
Angela?
Yes.
Item number 9, where you had contact Cal Fire and the United States Forest Service.
Yes.
I would make a suggestion that what you do is you put in there, contact Tracy Riggs at the Office of Emergency Services for Tuolumne County, and she can orchestrate all of the pertinent people as far as this being an emergency services facility.
I will see that the heads up here know exactly what you just
it
said.
It used to be
and
years
it's
ago.
Been handled. I think it's that been part handled. That was
yeah, that's been.
For some reason, there was a concern about the different fires.
They overlooked us and went to Gallup. Skipped us to go to
apparently there was somebody who named the Cal Fire
no,
and didn't
no,
go to the
I'm sorry, that's not correct. I had a chance to talk to Josh White, the head of the Cal Fire business for, I think, Calaveras and
the 12th Calaveras
and you guys need to talk to him because what he told me was totally different than what you guys are making decisions on. Yeah. Somebody needs to talk to him.
And that will happen. I will see yeah. that happens. That was on the list. Any other questions? Oh my. You guys just see me stand up here.
Well,
lay it off.
I realize I'm just going to address this to the board. And
okay.
So anyway, so we rent these buildings like heck, you know. But, and they put on a big successful event. And all we get out of it is building rental money. Now maybe I'm total ignorance about this, but if somebody's going to make $100,000, is there some way the fairgrounds can get a percentage of that, other than just the building rent?
Yeah, no,
they do get
that.
Oh, sure.
As we get more sophisticated, we'll look at deals differently. You know, rate cards aren't always the best means of assessing the value of your venue versus, you know, we wouldn't do a rate card with Trado probably because they're going to be looking at a different type of event. Than say a wedding that's coming in for you know 3 or 4 hours.
That's just around.
Yeah, and that's one of the things we did when I told you we were looking at rates was for that because somebody else will pay $500 for this and another you know.
Or partnerships is what
yes.
I think Trado's looking at, and that's where we can be helpful to them to help them grow their business. And as they grow, we'll grow financially, and they'll grow. So.
Isn't that just penalizing the people that promote?
Well, I still got to turn, I'm just saying there are some instances, I think what Barb was saying, where, you know, rate cards work and they don't work. But again, that's neither here nor there for discussion tonight.
Right, but none of you guys are saying anything about event size. When you rent one building for a small event, like you say in a video game or something like that, you have ample parking. When you have big events that rent the whole ground, you've only got 94 on the pavement up there, 60 on the slab out there. Where are we going to bring all the people in? And if we do all the marketing and all the legwork, and then you want to upcharge us for having a larger event, that's penalizing us for doing good work.
Well, nobody's upcharging anybody right now. The parking has not come up, by the way, which I know.
And parking is about the worst thing on this facility. You know, you guys are talking about CAL FIRE. We did free meals for Westside during the RIM fire because they have ample grounds out there at the old Bell place. And that's the same thing with Calaveras. Calaveras has got a lot of parking out there. I mean, the old airstrip all around down by the gun club, there's just so much parking that they have. And you guys are not looking at the capacity and the logistic capacity of this facility. It's great to have all these other things, but when you want to do large events and rent all the buildings and everything all at once, where are we going to put the people? When you can only do 400 and something cars, or I mean people, two people per car, that's nothing. A lot of the stuff that you guys rent to the craft fair or the weddings and stuff, they're parking on ground. Now with the Mother Lode Fair, there is no parking on grounds. The parking is reserved for livestock, and there's only a little bit of slab out there for staff. The parking is the biggest situation.
They come in on bus. There's a lot of parking.
Well, and we do shuttles here for the Celtic Fair. That's it. But you know, not all the time we can get the Walmart parking lot for shuttles, or we can't get the junction parking lot to do the shuttles.
So during the fair, when you said that the parking was just for livestock back there, that's not true. Anyone that wants a parking pass for the fair can come into the office and purchase it. It's just mostly that livestock runs in and gets them as quick as they can.
Well,
but that's available
to
everyone.
Back there when my daughters used to show goats.
Right, but you can, even if you're not in livestock, you can still buy one of those parking passes.
But I mean, it's limited.
It is limited.
Brian, when Brian Adcock was on the fair board, he and I went out with Tim Miller. Connie, you probably need to hear this. Tim Miller and I and Brian Adcock went out to some property that the city owns, which is behind out
South
here, Lake. Almost out to the TUD.
South Lake.
The city would be willing to sell it to us. Of course, we don't have any money, but there is parking if we leveled that out there.
Well, we've actually looked at that too for using that up there, and it does take a lot of work to get that. It's not in great repair, and the road getting to it once you get past the gate is pretty. It's pretty pity.
Parking definitely is a weakness.
Especially for large events.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're renting the John Muir and having a gun show or something, it's ample because you can use the site.
I've been to a few large events. There's a reason why primary parking spots for large events are charged parking. Why don't you charge? I mean, if it's going to be a prime parking space and I can pull up with my wife and three kids, park on the spot, I'd surely spend $10 to park this close. And then everybody else, it's a limited amount of parking. I think we all agree upon that. So if you're going to get a prime parking space, well, why isn't it charged?
It's like the Polar Express, though. You know, when you park down there for that event, for those things, it was $5 a car. I mean, it was $4,000 or $5,000 a weekend could be made by a group to do that kind of thing. So I mean, it's not that hard.
Well,
you have space.
The events, but I would say that it's a revenue stream that could be generated to bring just, even if it's small revenue, it's some revenue.
So for the board. Okay, so I'm sorry, Kathy, do you have any questions?
No, I'm mumbling.
So, thank you, Angela. So we're getting down now to where
begin to identify some common themes, and then identify what our recommendations are for priorities for the board to consider. And again, I want to take into consideration, we currently don't have a CEO, so some of this isn't going to move as quickly as we would like. There are other challenges facing the board, as you've all heard, from an infrastructure standpoint, from a budget perspective. So we shouldn't expect that all of this is going to be executed or carried out in the very near future. But it does provide a plan, a roadmap, a path to travel as we move forward to begin executing some of this. So are there things that you heard tonight that you would recommend the board consider as its top priorities, say, over the next 12 months?
I do have a suggestion for you guys. I've been doing logistic layouts on this grounds for about 8 years. And when you guys lay out the Mother Lode Fair, you block off the end down there with the carnival, and it cuts people from going off into the livestock area. Now, all you have to do is straight down behind the arena, put a gate and that fence down there and not block that off. You create a straight thoroughfare through the fairgrounds, and you can get that traffic down there. All you need is a simple gate in that chain.
Yeah, I think we heard that in Rachel's report when we talked about
it. Yeah, in her report, not getting people down there. You guys create a horseshoe down there, and it redirects the flow of people. And people are just like cattle, and you need that straight line to go straight through the grounds.
That was talked about last year at the fair.
Yeah.
We were supposed to do some lighting for a walkway. The carnival came in and blocked every route that we had to light a pathway. We're going to do street lamps all the way down to light a pathway to the livestock area. And when we came in here, there was big rigs and all the carnival guys just blocked everything. So that was a logistics thing when the carnival came in. But that's been an issue I know that's talked about with our production side of things.
Did you ever talk to the fair board about it? Because they never heard about it.
Been discussed for years.
Last year Stacy tried to do it.
The fair board hadn't heard about it though.
Hey, I've come for years and brought that up.
Yeah, that was actually written in the logistic report back in when Jan was CEO.
Yes.
Yeah, Stacy tried to do that last year, but the carnival people messed it up.
Well, again, that's an easy vendor. They're a vendor. You can tell them to leave your thoroughfare open.
Easily resolved. So again, priorities. What have you heard
that
you would suggest the board focus on over the course of this year?
Well, I think the marketing and public relations, communications, those are you can't get anywhere until you do those things. That's just my viewpoint.
Well, I think pursuing something, like you said, the capital improvement with people working and having events.
It's kind of a chicken and egg, you know, kind of tough spot. Yeah.
You've got to get your social media and your online stuff up to speed. I mean, just the fact that it hasn't been updated in 3 years. I mean, whether it's a site that's misrepresenting themselves as the fair board or the fairgrounds or whatever it is, it's an easy fix that can happen in a matter of 4 hours.
And that's part and parcel of what you're suggesting in terms of...
And it goes back to infrastructure. I mean, that's part of infrastructure. It's part of facility infrastructure. It's part of public perception and how people perceive the fair versus other fairs and other events that they're going to have.
What would that take for somebody in your category, your position, to help something like that?
Probably about... 3 or 4 hours? I mean, it's about 3 or 4 hours.
Yeah, it's the level of professionalism we have to create.
Yeah, I mean, you got to present yourself like you're a professional organization that's trying to attract outside vendors, outside events, and consumers that are being pulled in a variety of different ways in going to Disneyland, going down to the Bay Area, going camping. You got to give them a reason to show up to this facility for whatever event it is that they're looking at. And if you have a Facebook page that hasn't been updated in 3.5 years, they're going to go, well, this is a little bit of clownery, and I'm not going to show up.
Yeah. No, because fairs already have a strike against them. People have a mindset of what a fairgrounds looks like, and so it's how you create that feeling that, hey, we are capable of doing, you know, trade-o events, or we're capable of pulling off,
you know, Celtic Fair or other big events like that. We're not just livestock.
There's a whole community of people, and Ryan, you probably know this, that like that corny fairground weekend experience. They want to go to that, but they need to, you know, just as an outsider, the vantage point that I see is we're kind of caught between having that perception but not stepping up to do some of the things that either modern technology or the new wave of people that want to go to fairs want to see, and the type of things that they want to experience when they go to those type of events.
And those social media avenues aren't just getting Facebook page back up and going, it's being active on it, maintaining it, not monthly but weekly. And during fair time, it's
hourly. I mean, yeah. I don't know how many of you guys watch what we do on the Bourbon Barrel Facebook page or how many of you are friends with it. We are literally on that page probably, what, 5 to 7 times a day sometimes? And we don't even have an event going on. We're constantly feeding people. It's out of sight, out of mind. If people aren't seeing us provide updates on bourbon contests or what bands we have or parades in the downtown area, we're just we're out of sight, we're out of mind.
Another volunteer opportunity.
What food you serve?
Captain.
So there's an old adage that people remember, what, 25% of what you tell them, 50% of what they read, but 100% of how you make them feel. And when you come here to the fairgrounds, even if things aren't perfect or logistics aren't perfect, how does the fairgrounds representatives make you feel? And I can put up with an awful lot if at least they make me feel like I'm welcome, they're glad we're here, this is a great thing for the community, whatever, whatever.
So the customer service.
So the customer service to me ranks right up there with capital improvements.
Yes, the grounds committee for the fair board has been working on a 5-year plan. That needs to be approved so that we have something to go forward with on the capital improvements. Otherwise, we're just drifting again.
As far as goal number 4, the first step is identifying what are the needs for improvement in the buildings and the grounds, and what are they and how much would they cost to get them done? I was kind of thinking of all these plans, action items. What's the first step in order to be able to work through the rest of the list? What's the first step needed in each of them?
So that gets back to kind of the 5-year plan that, that Dan and his committee is working on.
One of our problems is that we have so many things facing us. It's so difficult for us to get that one start, get that one foot in the door and just start working on it. I mean, because we have a problem with revenue, we've got a problem with the leak, I mean, today and here, you know. So that one first step, we've got to do it and move on.
I mean, I like Kathy's comment, customer service doesn't really cost anything. It's just a matter of how we communicate and interact with people, and that's something easy to do. And I think Kathy's spot on that people are willing to accept some leaks in the building because they know how challenged we are to make things work. But if they walk away having a good experience, then they can overlook that stuff. Okay, so we got the marketing, PR, the customer service, establishing what the needs are for improvement, which gets back to the 5-year plan, which then kind of rolls into that sponsor luncheon, which I think is a cool idea. Because again, it gives us another source of feedback from people in the community that maybe aren't represented here tonight as to how they feel about the fair and its importance in their investment.
Right.
Yes, Kathy?
You know what? Part of a lot of this, just from an outside perspective, I don't know anything about the internal workings and all of that, but when you present the workings of the fair in such a negative, messy manner out to the community, you're almost inviting negativity about the whole fairgrounds. You've got to change the venue of how you're presenting this to the local community, who will be more than likely to invite or encourage or at least talk to other places to come. But when they know all the garbage, you know, your people are already going into it with an attitude kind of thing. And I mean, I think the fair itself, the fair board, and folks themselves have to present a much more encouraging and work together, which it sounds like it's kind of changed a little bit to a better working environment. But this community knows too much.
Well, I think...
And you got to get away from that if you're going to promote something to make it better.
Well, we had a meeting last month. We presented a balanced budget. People that attended the meeting, I think everybody walked away. Somebody said it was the first time they went home. Can't remember what her exact comment was, but she wasn't jittery when she left.
Yeah, it was a nice meeting.
It got back to the transparency issues, because the transparency issue is important, and the board was very transparent in terms of the budget that they adopted and the changes that they had to make in order to...
But it wasn't out there.
Excuse me?
It wasn't out there.
No, I know, and again, that's a challenge for the fair right now, because we don't have the staff, the CEO in particular, that can help with that. But that's something we know we have to improve, and it's one of our 14 recommendations.
Like you say, you can push yourselves on social media. You can get your good word out there. Unfortunately, newspapers, the local media, they're going to report the things that are turmoil and upheaval. That's their job. That's what sells their papers. But there are ways you can internally promote your good things.
I think the community wants to get behind us. I mean,
they do.
Look, we know all the negative stuff, and we showed up tonight because we want, this has to succeed. There isn't an opportunity to fail. And we are going to get behind this 150%. And I, you know, as far as my team goes, you guys know, I mean, I don't hear any of the negative stuff. We push all the negative stuff aside, and we just forge forward and say, let's just, we're action item people. And I don't really care about the negative stuff that's happened in the past. We care about figuring out some way to be an assistant or point us in a direction and tell us how to operate and how to get involved with you guys to make sure that there are great events down here and that we succeed in the world.
Yes.
I can't speak for the entire city council. I'll speak for myself, but I think I've got a feeling for the city council that anything that we can do as city folks, we're there to help. Financially, we're strapped, so that's not in the cards. But as far as like being on our website, I don't know if we are. Frankly, I have
a good idea.
And we're redoing our website, so it's certainly going to be okay to put in there to do that. But I think anything the city can do, I don't know how many other fairgrounds are located within the city limits, but I suspect it's not very many in the state of California. And so that's a unique opportunity to work with the city on the fairgrounds.
Thanks to your comments.
I think going along that with being on other organizations' web pages or Facebook pages, whatever, is extremely important. In the past, Carol Dowd has brought up several times the different the Board of Supervisors meetings, the City Council meetings, the Vision Sonora meetings, that we should have some sort of representation there, constantly being out in the community, in front of these other boards, in front of their people, letting them know what's going on, just, you know, a couple of second plug, just to let them know that we're here and that, you know, here's what we're doing and we're moving forward. And so I think it's an extremely important factor that we try and attend, somebody at least tries to attend some of these during the month.
Yes.
Just kind of going off of what Doug was saying, you know, how I think the whole community does want to be a part of this and back it up. Maybe adding to 4.3 for the volunteer program. What it, I don't know if, you know, what those two improvements is for the venue. If there are small projects like even trash pickup or getting the community to come out and meet, doing a community cleanup type of day, you know, rally behind it, you know, put it on social media, put it on the calendar of events, talk to Lisa, you know, have the Visitors Bureau even promote it, whoever can promote it, and make it a whole big community event where people feel like they're part of improving this venue and making it, you know, what it can be.
Get the Boy Scouts out here, the football teams, right. Get the JV varsity teams, get them all out here.
Yeah. Today we had some committee meetings, and just exactly what you were talking about, we are going to come up with the list
of different things that need to be done on the fairgrounds, that community organizations could handle. We're going to send it out, and the idea of putting on Facebook and things like that. We were talking about just those things, you know, updating our website. We know that it isn't the best way to get information out, but we still need that to post things. But we will, or we were talking about Facebook. You know, we have a link there. You know, we really need to improve that, and just like you said. And that did come up in our committee meetings today. And we are talking about those kind of things, and we will have that list out soon, different things, and we will get it posted. We'll send it out, we were going to send it out to different organizations, service clubs, things like that, and say, here's a list of what we have, you know, what would you like to, or what could you do for us? We, you know, we did discuss a lot of this that was discussed today in our committee meetings today, and we really want to get together with some groups, and maybe we can, we definitely need to get together with you and find out what your plans are and make sure they don't, you know, interfere with like the Celtic Fair or the All Hallows Day and things like that. Yeah, we will get
and
together.
And lean on us for social media stuff. I mean, we,
yeah.
At no charge. I mean, we've got a team in an office complex a quarter mile up the road where we can step in and help you guys with, you know, coming up with a strategy. What's the strategy for Instagram? What are you doing for Facebook? How are you approaching the website? All that type of stuff. It's not going to cost you anything. Yeah. Let us help you because the bigger and the more robust we can make this facility, the better off it is for everyone.
We will definitely have a couple board members come up and visit you. Unfortunately, because of the Bagley Teen Act, and I don't know how many of you are familiar with that, if you have more than three board members, two more than two, it's a meeting and we have to post it. So there'll be a couple board members coming to visit and start talking about it with you.
So this is not the end of the process. It just gets us to kind of the starting point now. So we're going to continue to communicate with you. We're going to continue to reach out to you. Our goal and priority is getting a CEO hired, and Jeff and Missy and Marge can talk about that quickly. But before they do that, all the candidates are coming tonight. We'll put you in an email database, so we'll make sure you get the board interviews every month. All the documents that the board receives are public documents, are available to the public. There's very little that you don't have access to as a public member, because everything we do, we live in a fishbowl, so if there's information you want from us, please reach out to us. Recognize we don't have a lot of staff, but we'll work to get you what you need. Great information tonight. The committees did really good work. I'm really impressed.
We should say thank you.
What everybody did. Can execute on all this stuff, okay? Time, given enough time and moving forward. So just to close, Jeff, you were missed here.
Yeah, just real quick as a reminder, the sign-up sheet's in the back. If you have it, please sign up. About a week or so ago, the CEO position was advertised. It's a 119-day employee position at $25 an hour. A lot of work went into the recruitment package. Looking for somebody with good customer service skills, good business skills, some fair knowledge. And so we encourage you to tell your friends, tell your family. The board members have been great at reaching out. The application is on the website as well as in the office. So Kathy or Marge, when they're in the office, just stop on by and pick it up. Missy and Marge also are familiar. I started with Peggy and Mickey helped develop the package, and then Missy and Marge were sort of let's get the word out there. So I believe it made it to the paper as well.
Yes.
And so not just our local paper, but I think Modesto.
It was sent to Modesto and to Merced Sun Star. However, I don't get those papers, so I don't know what they actually put out. But the press releases were sent. And then it was posted on my Facebook page, and it's been shared on a few other Facebook pages.
online.
If anybody is interested and willing to take on a wonderful challenge with a very wonderful board and a wonderful community, I encourage you to spread the word. The petition's open till filled, so we're hoping that the 11th, hopefully by the end of the month, we'll start to get the applications together. We'll have a screening committee of Missy and Marge, Brian, myself, and probably one or two other community members, which was a request by the community a few months ago to start reviewing. And so, you know, we're really hoping to have somebody on board in the next month and a half to 2 months. It depends upon, though, the level of advertising. So you're our greatest advertiser. So if you know of anybody who might be interested, you know, strong arm them, get them into the office, tell them to go to the Mother Lode Fair website. See something being pointed at. So, anyhow, we appreciate any interest. Marge, anything else you'd like to add as part of their recruitment efforts?
No, just make sure you get the word out. We do need a CEO desperately.
We have a fair coming up.
Yes.
Ryan said he'd love to do it.
You can fill out his application and just, you know, sign it.
I said it. Fill it out once.
It's online. I mean, come on.
Was it on Facebook?
I'll send it to you.
I just have one comment, and I think a lot of people in this room should either email, fax, or phone Clark Broadcasting on my Mother Lode and the Union Democrat and say, where were you? Because they hear from me a lot. So if I call up, it's probably not going to mean anything. But where were they? And they should be held accountable for that. This is news.
Again, we are beginning to rebuild that support base, if you will. People are beginning to see and read that, you know, we're moving forward.
But they need a phone call going, where were you?
Okay, so round of applause for everybody.
Thank you.